Tonight on Intimate Portrait.
David, would you like to kiss me?
Would I?
Yes. A nice, steady kiss. Not on roller skates this time.
Roller skates?
You don't remember?
I remember I had a pair of roller skates.
I was 9 years old, and you had your arms around me because you were teaching me to skate backwards. And suddenly you kissed me. I've never forgotten.
Her chic style, everlasting grace, and noble spirit made her one of the most intriguing people in history. From the moment she appeared on the screen, Audrey Hepburn had the ability to make audiences fall in love with her. Her unique combination of naivete and sophistication skyrocketed her to stardom almost overnight. She was paired on screen with some of the greatest leading men Hollywood had to offer, from Gregory Peck and Cary Grant to Fred Astaire and Sean Connery. Yet behind her regal beauty, Audrey's life was filled with complicated twists and turns. As a child, she witnessed the horrors of the Second World War and suffered from malnutrition. Her meteoric rise to stardom was clouded by divorce and miscarriage, leaving her to fear that lifelong love and the joys of motherhood would elude her. But Audrey's positive outlook helped her overcome whatever obstacles life handed her. She never took her stardom for granted and ultimately found a way to use her fame as a means to give back to others, devoting herself during the last years of her life to children around the world.
Being without food or being fearful for one's own life or bombings or fighting and all of that has made me terribly appreciative, of course, of food, of safety, of liberty. So in that sense, what were bad experiences have become positive in my life.
When Audrey died in 1993, the legacy she left behind would make her one of the most beloved celebrities of all time. In her last rare appearances, Audrey, her son Sean Ferrer, and her last companion in life, Robert Walters, take us inside the world of this very private woman. Tonight, Audrey Hepburn, an intimate portrait. Audrey Hepburn Rustin was born May 4, 1929 in Brussels, Belgium, the daughter of a Dutch baroness, Ella von Heemstra, and her second husband, Joseph Hepburn Rustin, an Irish banker. Born to Dutch nobility, Audrey and her two half-brothers, Jan and Alexander, enjoyed a privileged life during their early years. But the 1930s were a time of great unrest in Europe, when Hitler was coming into power, and the comfortable life Audrey knew would soon change dramatically. When she was 6 years old, Audrey's father left home. The feelings of abandonment she suffered at losing the father she adored would be something she would struggle with her entire life.
There was a great deal of pain involved, because before the war, after he'd left us, my mother explained very sweetly that he'd gone away on a trip and she didn't think he was coming back. I was terribly jealous of other little girls who did have adoring daddies and all of that. And my mother did a wonderful thing. She never, ever spoke against him.
In 1939, war broke out in Europe. A year later, Hitler invaded Holland. And for 5 long years, war became a way of life for young Audrey.
Throughout our youth, she would always talk about what it's like to grow up in an environment where the basics that we're used to in today's world are not there. And you don't have your freedom. You're not able to go and say as you please. I think that's really what shocked her the most.
You live by the day. Then, little by little, yes, there was a knock on the door and they took my uncle away, who 6 months later was shot, and another uncle too. And my brothers went underground. That's when really the hard times started, because that's when so many reprisals were made and so many people were shot and so many people were rounded up and imprisoned. We did not yet know that they were going to their death. Those images have never, never left me.
Prior to the war, Audrey had discovered a love for dance, studying ballet with a passion. Though later she would downplay her involvement, during the war she did what she could to put her dancing skills to good use, giving ballet recitals to raise funds for the Dutch resistance. But as the war dragged on, Deprivation and malnourishment took their toll, and Audrey was too ill to dance. Then, on her 16th birthday, Holland was officially liberated. It was a day filled with memories that would impact Audrey's life many years later.
The day we were liberated was so exciting, and that's when life started again. The first thing I remember after our liberation in Holland was the Red Cross and UNICEF coming in and filling all the empty buildings that they could find with food and clothing and medication. So that was the first time I became aware of the word. It was then UNRWA and became UNICEF. Everything was new, everything was exciting, and that has stayed with me till today.
After the war, Audrey's mother single-handedly supported Audrey and herself in England. But her daughter's dream to be a great dancer would never be fulfilled.
She went to London and met with Marie Rambert, who was the great ballet teacher at the time, who told her, look, you have wonderful technique and you can always work here, you can always teach, you'll always be a great second ballerina, but you'll never be a prima ballerina. And I have the responsibility of telling you that. And she says that she came home that day and her dream had vanished and she just wanted to die. And actually, because she couldn't have her dream, she decided that she had to work and make a living anyway. And so she went on to acting, which didn't turn out so bad.
Audrey took what work she could in chorus lines and musicals, eventually landing bit parts in small British film productions. But it was during the shooting of a film called Monte Carlo Baby in the south of France that Audrey got her first big break. In this only known existing print of Monte Carlo Baby, Audrey's talent, even in her early years, is readily apparent.
Oh, are you still there? The air in the room seems suddenly less humid.
Because he's here in Paris?
You glitter with stupidity, Poulain.
Maybe.
Rudy's presence in Paris holds as much interest for me as the price of hashish in Siam.
During filming, the French novelist Colette discovered a new ingenue to star in the Broadway adaptation of her play Gigi. Colette recognized in Audrey a unique presence that no amount of training or preparation could create.
I don't believe it was ambition that brought Audrey to where she was as an actress or as a human being. Her success can be attributed to those people who believed in her, who saw this extraordinary thing in her, who were aware of that mystery and wanted to bring it out.
Before Audrey left for America, director William Wyler was looking for an unknown European actress to play the lead in a new film entitled Roman Holiday. Executives in Paramount's London office were familiar with Audrey's work and asked her to do a screen test.
I had seen Willie Wyler's screen test of Audrey Hepburn for the role she played in Roman Holiday. First, he did sort of an acting part, and then he kept the cameras rolling, even though he had said cut. And she became herself, and her own personality was there on the screen. And it was just so enchanting. That's what got her the role in Roman Holiday. And that started her great career.
In a heartbeat, Audrey was to become a leading actress in both a Broadway show and a big Hollywood film. The opportunities were enormous, but so were the burdens. As Audrey noted in her response to Paramount's decision to cast her in the lead, Lord, help me live up to all of this.
I just wanted to be a dancer, and I never planned to be an actress, and all of this just happened. And I'm still trying to catch up.
Coming up, Audrey goes from unknown ingenue to Hollywood star and becomes an overnight sensation.
This intimate portrait is sponsored by MCI's Friends and Family. You get savings. Simple.
Now you don't have to wait to save on international calls. With MCI World Savings, you're guaranteed one low rate, 24 hours a day to each country when you call any number you've selected. Places like Australia, Germany, Italy, and the Philippines. That's MCI's lowest rate day or night. So no matter where you call, you always save over AT&T. Call 1-800-999-4400 to join. MCI World, for citizens of the world.
CD changer, amplifier, four bookshelf speakers. Ordered by telephone on Cindy Reese's MasterCard. Delivered to 73 William Street. Does Cindy live at 73 William Street? Does anybody? MasterCard pioneered the address information management service. It helps secure transactions by making sure an address is legitimate. Not an abandoned warehouse. It can tell if someone lives there.
Nice place.
Although it can't say why.
Great neighborhood.
MasterCard. It's smart money.
At California Closets, we have custom design solutions for all your storage needs. California Closets, a place for everything. At California Closets, we have custom design solutions for all your storage needs. California Closets, a place for everything.
Is it Diet Dr. Pepper or regular? You have 10 seconds to decide. But if you can't tell the difference, don't worry. You probably can't taste the difference either. Even with all the time in the world, discover the great taste of Diet Dr. Pepper.
Is there a cat food that helps maintain cat's urinary tract health?
Cat Chow Special Care reduces urinary pH and provides low dietary magnesium. Purina Cat Chow Special Care brand cat food. Better care makes better cats.
A lifetime intimate portrait, Kathy Lee Gifford.
Who is this person?
She's sister, daughter, and best friend to millions.
I didn't know you had a pelvic thrust in you, Reed.
But beyond the image of dream come true is the real story.
People have a misconception. I guess it's that I'm this joyful, sort of silly person that has no problems and never struggled for anything in their life.
Hear it from the people who love her best. Intimate Portrait, Kathy Lee Gifford. Sunday at 10 p.m. on Lifetime.
He follows you, watches you. Too close, too familiar.
Looks like it's just me and you.
When you said no, he didn't listen.
I got a letter from Jack.
Now where do you turn?
Not going to work today.
When your office becomes a terror, when the danger won't disappear.
Harry likes me.
General Hospital's Rena Sofer.
He's got to be stopped.
Hostile Advances, the Carrie Ellison story, a Lifetime original movie. Premieres Monday, May 27th at 9 p.m., 8 central, only on Lifetime, television for women.
We now return to Audrey Hepburn, An Intimate Portrait. Gigi opened at the Fulton Theater in New York City on November 24th, 1951. The reviews were mixed, but the critics agreed. In her stage debut, Audrey Hepburn was a winner. During this time, Audrey became engaged to James Hansen, the son of a wealthy English industrialist. But their relationship ended soon after Audrey began filming Roman Holiday. In the film, Audrey plays a princess who, longing for a taste of the simple life, runs away from her royal duties for one day of adventure with an American journalist, played by Gregory Peck.
Would you be so kind as to tell me where I am?
Well, this is what is laughingly known as my apartment.
Have I been here all night alone?
If you don't count me, yes.
So I've spent the night here with you.
Oh, well, now, I don't know that I'd use those words exactly. But, from a certain angle, yes.
It was the first big movie, and certainly the big break that everybody dreams of if they, you know, if they want to get on. So I have enormous tenderness and gratitude, not only for William Wyler, but for Greg Peck, who accepted me. He could very well have said, no, I don't want an unknown to be in the picture with me, and I, you know, could have chosen for an established star.
So convincing was Audrey's portrayal of the royal princess that Roman Holiday was an instant success and brought her her first Academy Award for Best Actress. Paramount, looking to capitalize on its new star, gave the go-ahead for a movie adaptation of the play Sabrina Fair, to be directed by another great filmmaker, Billy Wilder. Screenwriter Ernest Lehman remembers meeting Audrey for the first time.
We were writing the role for Audrey Hepburn. She was under contract to Paramount, and I had seen her as the princess in Roman Holiday, and out from this nondescript apartment in Westwood stepped this 18-year-old or 19-year-old girl in slacks and a sweatshirt. What really enchanted me was the fact that, for some reason, she put her arms around me and kissed me on both cheeks. And I was a goner from then on.
Sabrina is the story of a chauffeur's daughter who must choose between two wealthy brothers, played by Humphrey Bogart and William Holden.
Taxi, miss. Cheapest rates in Glencoe.
Well, hello. How are you?
Well, I'm fine. How are you? And I might add, who are you?
Who am I?
Am I supposed to know?
Come to think of it, no, you're not supposed to know.
On screen, Sabrina chose the older brother, Linus, played by Bogart. But when the camera stopped rolling, Audrey found him irritable and cantankerous.
On the set, I think she was a little cowed by Bogey because he was irascible, but she never showed it. Bogey used to mimic Billy Wilder's Viennese accent, and Billy said terrible things to Bogey in front of everybody. I tell you, I can't describe how this lovely Cinderella story on the screen had such suffering going on behind the cameras.
And while Holden's character David was passed over by Sabrina in the film, in real life, Audrey and Holden were falling in love.
I happened to wander into a dressing room and realized I had stumbled into an embrace between Audrey and Bill Holden, and I was a little embarrassed because I had no idea anything like that was going on.
But Holden was married at the time, and Audrey realized she would have to end the affair. Holden would carry a torch for her his entire life. Sabrina gave Audrey the chance to go from working girl to femme fatale and introduced her to a young designer named Hubert de Givenchy, a collaboration that would soon change the face of fashion.
I don't think that Audrey had any awareness of how beautiful she was, because she didn't see herself as we saw her. She was, since her youth, so aware of what she regarded as her shortcomings that she was flattered every time, extraordinarily flattered whenever someone would offer a kind comment about her looks.
If Roman Holiday brought Audrey to our attention, Sabrina etched her into our consciousness and forever changed our concept of what a star should be. In August of 1953, when Audrey returned to London, Gregory Peck introduced her to a handsome, charismatic actor by the name of Mel Ferrer. Mel expressed an interest in working with Audrey and sent her a copy of Jean Giraudoux's play, Ondine. Less than a year later, the Broadway stage version of Ondine opened, co-starring Audrey Hepburn and Mel Ferrer.
I am Audrey Hepburn. Ondine is a very beautiful love story in which Mel Ferrer and I appear together. Mel plays the knight errant, and I play a water sprite.
Remarkably, just after winning her first Academy Award, Audrey received a coveted Tony Award for Ondine.
She believed that her success was due in part to her hard work, and certainly a great part of it to the leading men that she was fortunate enough to work with, the best directors that she was fortunate enough to work with. And she saw that as a great fortune.
I learned something new from all of them. But I suppose mostly professionalism, you know? Kindness, because they were sweet to me and always so wonderful to people around them, whether it was the crew or the people that came to visit them or the other actors, which is part of being a profession, I think, is being, you know, having dignity also in your work. And I just watched them like mad because I'd had no training. So I learned not a little bit from each of them, but a lot.
Audrey's insecurity made her work and study that much harder to compensate for her lack of training. In Mel, she found not only a father figure, he was 12 years her senior, but also a mentor who was instrumental in coaching her. When Ondine closed, Audrey was suffering from total exhaustion. She accompanied Mel to Italy, where he was working on another film. During a break in shooting, the two went off to Switzerland to be married.
He guided Audrey, I think, as a husband, not as a Svengali, as some people would have it. And I think years of their marriage coincides with the most successful part of Audrey's career. Some people have said that he was a father figure to her, be that as it may, I don't know, but I know that it was a wonderful love relationship, above all.
Much to her delight, in 1955, Audrey became pregnant. As successful as she was in her work, motherhood was the role she most coveted. But she soon miscarried and fell into a deep depression. Mel stayed by her side and convinced her to return to work. Together, they starred in the film War and Peace. But over the next several years, while Audrey's career continued to skyrocket with Funny Face and Love in the Afternoon, Mel's projects were far less successful. The press played up the differences between their careers, accusing Mel of trying to use Audrey and control her, which only made matters worse.
My father was always clear on trying to get the best directors, the best cameraman, best key elements. But I don't think he was this uber-controlling husband, Pygmalion type, who would give her the bottom line. I think he was really advising her, and I think he did well by it. And I think she chose as much as he did the films that she wanted to do.
With The Nun story in 1959, Audrey faced her most difficult challenge to date. Her compelling portrayal of a nun who questions her faith showed a versatility the world had not yet seen and earned her her third Academy Award nomination.
I think the film that reflects Audrey the most is The Nun story, to the extent where it is difficult for me to watch, because Audrey was, with all of her sense of fun, was extremely introspective, as is the character, Sister Luke. And what I see in the film, what I see in the character, is so close to Audrey in those moments where she was in turmoil, when there was something that she couldn't resolve.
I think she thought that Nun's Story was a very important film, in which she gave a, from her perspective, a very honest, and difficult performance. She had to stretch herself for that role in certain regards, and I think she had great respect for that role.
Shortly after filming, Audrey found out she was pregnant again, but had already committed to doing a Western with Burt Lancaster called The Unforgiven. For fear of losing her baby, she was reluctant to do the picture, which required her to ride horseback. Tragically, she fell from her horse during filming and broke her back. A short time later, she miscarried again. This time, her depression was even greater than before. She was beginning to think that she would never know the joy of motherhood. Coming up, Audrey and designer Givenchy make their mark on the world of fashion.
Lead car, take it slow. Everybody okay? Wait a minute, what's he doing? He wants more. Right there.
I want over there.
Diet Dr. Pepper, the taste you've been looking for.
Before you hit the wall, hit Sherwin-Williams for the best paint money can buy. Plus, thousands of wallpaper patterns with a low price guarantee. Before you hit the wall, hit Sherwin-Williams for supplies and advice to bring out the best in your walls. We've got everything you need. Save up to 25% on A100 exterior paint and register to win a trip for four to Universal Studios Florida. Sherwin-Williams, where to get it.
Imagine a dishwasher with a self-cleaning filter that makes hand-rinsing your dishes obsolete. Imagine, too, if that same dishwasher held more knives and forks and adjusted to handle whatever you needed to clean. And if it could do all of this quietly, it would be this dishwasher, Kenmore, proven to clean better than any other. Shouldn't you consider the brand that's already at work in over one out of two homes in America? Kenmore. Come see the innovative side of Sears.
Now you don't have to wait to save on international calls. With MCI World Savings, you're guaranteed one low rate, 24 hours a day to each country when you call any number you've selected. Places like Japan, France, the United Kingdom, and Mexico City. That's MCI's lowest rate day or night. So no matter where you call, you always save over AT&T. Call 1-800-999-4400 to join. MCI World, for citizens of the world.
It's your haven, your sanctuary. It's your home, and you'll spend more than half your life there. Shouldn't it be right? Your number one source of pride, comfort, and confidence. That's been Stanley Steamer's belief for over 48 years. From carpet to upholstery, we'll get it clean and we'll do it right. After all, we're not talking about just anywhere. We're talking about where you live. Stanley Steamer makes you feel right at home.
It gets harder and harder to find someone who will actually work for your business. One exception is Chicagoland's number two Honda dealer, Honda of Lyle. At Honda of Lyle, you don't have to take a number for service. You'll be taken care of immediately. And with the area's best selection of Accords, Preludes, Civics, Odysseys, and Passports, you're sure to get the car you want at the price you want. Trade in your old ideas about shopping for a new Honda. See number two, Honda of Lyle. We work harder for you. Just south of I-88 on Route 53 in the Lyle Auto Plaza.
At the mercy of a man.
You know, I really believe there's a part of him that loves me.
And ignored by a system.
He's threatening to kill me!
A woman who became a victim fought back the only way she could. See her stunning true life story.
The police are liable to Tracy Thurman because they violated her civil rights.
In a cry for help.
I'm gonna get you for that!
The Tracy Thurman story.
Tonight at 9, 8 Central on Lifetime. This is Lifetime, television for women. We now return to Audrey Hepburn, An Intimate Portrait. As afraid as she was of losing another baby, in the fall of 1959, Audrey became pregnant again. This time she was able to carry to term, and on July 17, 1960, in answer to her prayers, Audrey gave birth to her first child, a son, Sean Hepburn Ferrer.
The birth of my sons, that's the best thing that, you know, I can remember, the most marvelous experience. I know it happens every day, millions of times, but it's always a miracle, especially to the mother.
Motherhood played a very important role in my mother's life. She took it very seriously. She wanted to have kids very much. Prior to my birth, she lost two other babies, and she always referred to that as two of the most painful experiences in her life. And so when I was born and then subsequently Luca, she was as happy as you can be.
Because motherhood proved to be so elusive for so long, when Audrey finally gave birth to Sean, she would not even consider leaving him behind when she returned to work. Sean accompanied Audrey to the set of her next film, where she played what is probably her most memorable role, that of Holly Golightly in Breakfast at Tiffany's opposite George Peppard.
Holly, I'm in love with you.
So what?
So what? So plenty. I love you. You belong to me.
No. People don't belong to people.
Of course they do.
I'm not going to let anyone put me in a cage.
I don't want to put you in a cage. I want to love you.
It's the same thing.
No, it's not. Holly?
I'm not Holly. I'm not Lula May either. I don't know who I am. I'm like Cat here. We're a couple of no-name slobs. We belong to nobody, and nobody belongs to us. We don't even belong to each other.
With her simple black dress and broad black sunglasses, Audrey's pairing with designer Givenchy again turned the fashion world upside down, propelling Audrey's image to the cover of nearly every fashion magazine in print. Imitations of Givenchy's designs for Audrey were everywhere.
She had such style, and I, sitting around the first time I met her, she was just in slacks and a turtleneck, but she could wear lint and look stylish.
Can you think of anyone who was like her? I keep coming back to the word enchanting, singular, different. Thinness became the vogue. Off-the-shoulder dresses, cute hats, and those big eyes, and that wonderful smile. She changed style just as Jackie O did.
From their first collaboration together with Sabrina, through Funny Face Charade and How to Steal a Million, Audrey and Givenchy began an extraordinary friendship that lasted her entire lifetime.
The best thing that really happened to me, where it
elegance is concerned, if you like, is that I ended up at Givenchy's, who I'd been told was the newest, the youngest, the most exciting young designer on the scene. And it was love at first sight in every way.
She loved her relationship with fashion because of Hubert de Givenchy, because he was such a close friend. She kind of found a soulmate brother in him.
The simple, elegant style that Givenchy developed for Audrey continues to inspire fashion designers today.
I think whenever you're designing a very simple, pure collection, there's always going to be a few looks that come out that are something that you can say, well, that's very Audrey Hepburn. The black shift dress, a pair of skinny capri pants. It's the simplicity of styling. I think that's definitely in every collection I've ever seen.
Fashion through costuming would also play a big part in Audrey's ability to become whatever role she was playing. No role was a better example of this than Audrey's portrayal of Eliza Doolittle in the musical My Fair Lady, where with the aid of Cecil Beaton's magnificent costuming, Audrey was magically transformed from Cockney waif to regal beauty. But the film's grueling shooting schedule, combined with the press's constant demands for interviews, created an intense need in Audrey for privacy. She finally found a permanent home for her family in Tolochenaz, Switzerland, a farmhouse which she lovingly referred to as La Paisible, the peaceful place.
La Paisible meant home for me and home for my mother. This was the place that she'd always dreamed of. She always tells a story. She came one day, somebody said, you should look at this old farmhouse. And she pulled up at the bottom of the garden, and she stood on the hood of the car, and she looked over the wall, and she saw this kind of field with fruit trees in bloom and blossom. And she said, oh, she got butterflies in her stomach, and she knew that was it. She was home.
La Paisible was a place Audrey could raise Sean without the constant annoyance of the paparazzi. But even away from the media, she and Mel could not run away from their disintegrating marriage. Her next performance was a prophetic one. It was a picture entitled Two for the Road, about marital problems that paralleled her own. Soon after arriving on the set, rumors began to spread about an affair between Audrey and her co-star Albert Finney. A year later, in 1968, after working together for the last time on the thriller Wait Until Dark, Audrey and Mel were divorced.
They were both in a highly competitive business. And I think that Mel might have sometimes felt secondary to Audrey. He was a leading man when they met, and his career suffered over the years. And especially when the public or the press would compare it to Audrey's. And Audrey always remained very much aware of that, so she would never lay the blame at Mel's feet. It was something that came about, and something that could only be solved in one way, through divorce.
As a child who felt abandoned by her own father, Audrey made sure that Sean was able to see Mel as often as possible.
I think they both were tremendously saddened by the divorce. Both my mother and my father tried very hard to keep a good balance, where I would spend equal, or at least close to equal, if it wasn't quantity of time, certainly quality of time. I think that it's a bearable thing. Better than having two people unhappy and a child not knowing why and asking those questions. Children feel, they know when things are not right.
The summer before the divorce, while Audrey and Mel were separated, Audrey met an Italian psychiatrist named Dr. Andrea Dotti on a cruise. 2 months after the divorce became final, Audrey and Dotti were married. Dotti was younger than Audrey by 9 years and had no ties to Hollywood. Audrey was determined that her career would not cause this marriage to fail. Coming up, Audrey and her family face the threat of terrorism.
A lifetime intimate portrait, Kathy Lee Gifford.
Who is this person?
She's sister, daughter, and best friend to millions.
I didn't know you had a pelvic thrust in you, Rage.
But beyond the image of dream come true is the real story.
People have a misconception. I guess it's that I'm this joyful, sort of silly person.
that has no problems and never struggled for anything in their life.
Hear it from the people who love her best. Intimate Portrait, Kathy Lee Gifford. Sunday at 10 p.m. on Lifetime.
We at Dr. Pepper never thought anyone would duplicate our one-of-a-kind taste. But someone finally did. We did. Discover what millions already have, the great taste of Diet Dr. Pepper.
Now you don't have to wait to save on international calls. With MCI World Savings, you're guaranteed one low rate, 24 hours a day to each country when you call any number you've selected. Places like Australia, Germany, Italy, and the Philippines. That's MCI's lowest rate day or night. So no matter where you call, you always save over AT&T. Call 1-800-999-4400 to join. MCI World, for citizens of the world.
This is how the day ends. Simmering on the horizon. And as the dark pulls its covers down tight, we curl up in our beds and whisper, good night. Serta, we make the world's best mattress.
Ladies, is this a closet
or time capsule?
Let's clean up with Worthington, shall we? Worthington is totally great work clothes, with next to no work at all. These are suits and separates that get along beautifully. Fit great, go classic to contemporary in under 30 seconds, and treat your wallet with respect. So you could swap out these things for one thing. Worthington, it works for working women, and it's only at JCPenney.
I'm not partying with my puka beads.
374-90042.
Account code.
963-400.
Fax.
697-364.
Cellular.
889-26801.
Since the last thing you need is one more number to remember, MasterCard is developing the single-digit PIN code. Someday, a computer chip in your card will recognize your unique mark, so your personal identification code is personal. It's how the future will be paid for. MasterCard. It's smart money.
Bugbegon from Ortho, the only ready-to-use diazinon bug killer that kills virtually any bug, anywhere.
What kinds of snacks do you crave?
Sweet and salty. Both.
Try crunch and munch whatever you're craving. Popcorn, peanuts, and rich buttery toffee.
I can't stop eating it.
This is wonderful. I just love it.
I could eat an entire box of that.
Crunch and munch. It's perfect whatever you're craving.
We now return to Audrey Hepburn, An Intimate Portrait. Audrey had left Hollywood behind to focus on her new marriage to Dr. Doughty.
So Audrey made a deliberate decision to stop acting because she felt that her work might have been in large part responsible for the coming apart of her marriage to Mel. And when she remarried after her divorce, her husband being a doctor whom she felt should lead a life away from film sets, lead a real life, she just decided she wasn't going to work anymore.
But what Audrey could not know was that her self-imposed exile was exactly the opposite of what Doughty wanted. Instead of the glamour and excitement he expected from being married to a movie star, Doughty was surprised when Audrey was content to take the more traditional role of wife and mother. On February 8, 1970, she gave birth to her second son, Luca. She took up permanent residence in Rome and focused all of her attention on her new family. In the 70s, Western Europe was struck by a wave of terrorism and kidnappings targeting the wealthy. After a failed attempt to kidnap Doughty and repeated threats on young Sean and Luca, Audrey was faced with a painful decision.
She came to me and she said, well, here's a situation. I'm nervous as hell. I can't sleep at night because I'm afraid for your well-being. But if you tell me that you're going to be so miserable to be away from the family, we'll try and work it out. But it won't be the kind of life that I wish for you because you won't have the freedom that I expect you to have as a as a young man of your age. And so I said, look, a combination of everything that you're saying and the fact that it's making your life difficult. We'll see each other, you know, on holidays and weekends and whatever. And so packed my bags and left.
Audrey and Luca returned to La Paisible to be near Sean, with Dottie commuting between Rome and Toloshenaz weekly. But the separation took its toll on their marriage. Alone in Rome during the week, Dottie returned to the nightlife he'd enjoyed as a bachelor. Gossip soon began to spread about his playboy activities. Unlike the fairy tale movies she had made for Audrey in real life, there was no storybook ending. She and Dottie were divorced in 1979. Prior to her divorce, Audrey briefly returned to the screen. In Robin and Marian, she found a film that her children could enjoy and a role that she felt comfortable in, that of the mature maid Marian opposite Sean Connery's Robin Hood. Over the next 10 years, the five-time Oscar-nominated actress made only a few more film appearances, culminating in her final and, for some, most appropriate screen performance, that of an angel in Steven Spielberg's Always.
She was eager to say that she never really retired. Many scripts were submitted to her, and she just felt that they made the mistake of thinking of her as the ingenue that she had been 30 years before. She wanted to play her age, and those parts were not attractive.
Still, Audrey continued to bear the heartache of her two failed marriages. At about the same time, actor Robert Walters was recovering from the death of his wife, actress Meryl Oberon. They found solace in each other at a time when both were experiencing great loss.
We met in Los Angeles in the winter of 79-80. In fact, we met a short while after my wife had died. Audrey extended herself a great deal to me, spoke to me in our native tongue, which is Dutch, and spoke to me almost exclusively about her love for my wife.
Eventually, their friendship turned to romance. In Rob, Audrey had finally found the life partner she had always searched for.
They seemed like a great, great couple that had been with one another for many, many more years than they had, and maybe been together for maybe 40, 50 years. They seemed so happy together.
They cared and loved each other tremendously. And I think she felt very safe with him, and she spent very happy 12 years with him.
Coming up, Audrey plays the most important role in her life.
This intimate portrait is sponsored by Dr. Pepper and your local Dr. Pepper bottler.
Surprisingly, your washing machine can have more to do with getting your laundry clean than your detergent. And one laundry system is proven to perform better than any other. Kenmore. Designed with an exclusive agitator system that ensures that whatever you're washing gets circulated throughout, as if it were in there alone. Working so quietly, you might forget it's there. Shouldn't you consider the brand that's already at work in over one out of two homes in America? Kenmore. Come see the innovative side of Sears.
Now you don't have to wait to save on international calls. With MCI World Savings, you're guaranteed one low rate, 24 hours a day to each country when you call any number you've selected. Places like Japan, France, the United Kingdom, and Mexico City. That's MCI's lowest rate day or night. So no matter where you call, you always save over AT&T. Call 1-800-999-4400 to join. MCI World, for citizens of the world.
CD changer, amplifier, four bookshelf speakers. Ordered by telephone on Cindy Reese's MasterCard. Delivered to 73 William Street. Does Cindy live at 73 William Street? Does anybody? MasterCard pioneered the Address Information Management Service. It helps secure transactions by making sure an address is legitimate. Not an abandoned warehouse. It can tell if someone lives there.
Nice place.
Although it can't say why.
Great neighborhood.
MasterCard. It's smart money.
Every day the face goes on. Each night it comes off. This night, naked eyes freeze in the faucet. Evidence of 45 years. Evidence of living. Are the jars of miracles telling fibs? Where's the newer, younger you? Little girls want to be women. Women want to be little girls. She laughs off the laugh lines, reminding herself the newer, younger you isn't found in a jar.
Don't act so surprised. I get them too. The dreaded yeast infection. And like most women, I feel better about asking my doctor which over-the-counter treatment she recommends. Monistat 7. Yeah, Monistat. There's still no faster or safer cure. All those reports, nearly 200, convinced some pretty demanding doctors. Hey, life is unpredictable enough. I'm going with a number one doctor-recommended cure. Like most women, Monistat.
When my allergies became a problem, I thought a prescription was the answer. Instead, my allergist recommends Dimetapp. Said an allergy study showed its antihistamine is even more effective than Seldane, a leading prescription. Ask your doctor.
Doctors say Dimetapp for good reason.
It felt nourishing, like it was still penetrating my skin. Even when I went to bed, I could still feel it working.
Dove Moisturizing Body Wash contains a unique 8-hour moisturizing formula.
It just sort of clings on and it lasts all day.
Dove Moisturizing Body Wash for soft skin all day long.
We now return to Audrey Hepburn, An Intimate Portrait. At last, Audrey had found the contentment in her personal life that had for so long eluded her. She and Rob shared a life of simple pleasures.
She didn't go out a lot. She didn't mingle a lot with so many different people. She didn't go to a lot of parties or dinners or lead a very social life. She loved her home, her dogs, her roses, her garden.
Gardening became more than just a hobby for Audrey. It became a passion she was able to share. In Gardens of the World, a video series she was asked to host and with which she became deeply involved.
This is Holland. In February, when the cold mist rises, there's a promise of spring in the air. I spent most of my childhood here. Spring. I love the first tulips of spring.
What began as a simple showcase for beautiful gardens took on new life as the producers realized the strength of Audrey's vision and enthusiasm.
Her aspiration for the series would be to bring beauty to people through television and to bring beauty that was lyrical and that was poetic in how it was presented.
Oh, Rose, asked Elizabeth Barrett Browning, who dares to name thee?
Audrey's contribution elevated this simple project to a new level, making Gardens of the World one of the most successful video series of its kind.
I think she really loved putting her hands into the earth and had a great appreciation for sort of the miracle of nature. One of the things she said initially about gardening when we first met with her in Switzerland is that she thought gardening was the ultimate therapy and that it can sort of enrich the spirit and the soul.
Audrey's involvement and dedication would prove an asset to a much greater cause when she was asked by UNICEF to speak on behalf of children around the world.
UNICEF came about in late 87. We were asked by a family member of Audrey's if we would speak to people who were organizing a festival in Macau, in China, for the benefit of UNICEF. And then it was requested that she become Goodwill Ambassador for UNICEF. And for the next 5 years, we worked for them constantly.
I must be the envy of many, because how many people have said to me, what can we do, you know? Well, I was offered, you know, a wonderful opportunity to do something. And that's really the best feeling one can have.
Towards the end of Audrey's life, as her film career had come to a close, she discovered that her celebrity was a way to help others. And she was rather surprised at how much attention that she was able to garner for the things that she did. And once she did see that, she was really bent on taking the best part of that celebrity and giving something back.
Where Audrey had once shunned the media, she now became highly visible and vocal, spreading the news about conditions in places like Ethiopia and Somalia, and brought national attention to this world crisis.
The question I'm most frequently asked is, what do you really do for UNICEF? Clearly, my task is to inform, to create awareness of the needs of children, to fully understand the problems of the state of the world's children. It would be nice to be an expert on education, economics, politics, religions, traditions, and cultures. And I'm none of these things. But I am a mother and will travel.
Audrey had come full circle from her earliest remembrances about the UN's relief efforts after World War II to becoming UNICEF's goodwill ambassador to the world. And she threw herself into it heart and soul.
The children always mingled around her because she was always among them, and she was always, she would sit down and play with them, or would take them, and they would climb on her, and she was, would be surrounded. Audrey really put her whole being into it.
During her last trip to Somalia, Audrey began to complain of stomach pains. In October of 1992, she was rushed to Cedars-Sinai Hospital in Los Angeles, where doctors removed a tumor from her colon. The news was devastating. Audrey was suffering from advanced pancreatic cancer. She did not have long to live. She returned home to Switzerland to spend her last Christmas with her family.
Neither the boys nor I would acknowledge that she was actually dying. We couldn't imagine that she could. She was too precious. And we perhaps made a mistake in not letting her know how ill she was. In retrospect, I think that was very unfair to her, because Audrey was as realistic about death as she was about life. And when she began to sense that it was happening, she made us promise that we would let her go when she would indicate that she felt it was time. And we promised to do that, but I don't think we followed through. And we were begging for every minute, really. It's totally unfair to someone who is that courageous. And yet I don't know if we wouldn't behave the same way today.
We were, of course, shocked and dismayed and horrified and angry. And she said, no, this is part of life. Death is just another phase of life. And she made peace with it. We had the wonderful opportunity to say to each other and share all the things that you want to be able to share with someone when you know they're not going to be there. I think that she felt that her last Christmas was her best Christmas, because, and I can't tell you exactly why, she felt at that time we were all around her and we were there for the right reasons, and she said she was now sure that we really loved her.
Audrey Hepburn died on January 20th, 1993. She was buried in a quiet ceremony near her beloved home in Tolochenaz, Switzerland. With her passing, the world lost an extraordinary human being.
She was so extraordinarily giving and compassionate, and her generosity really had no bounds to where she would. Even though she was doing the work, she would thank me constantly for what I was doing and for, in her words, making it possible. Extraordinary graciousness. So she gave me a great deal of self-worth. Subsequently, I had a great sense of failure when she died, because she made me feel that I could protect her. She entrusted herself to me.
I felt, and I still feel, I was extremely privileged to have known her also in, on a private basis, and feel her love for me as well. And those 5 years, I think they made an enormous difference in my life and in everything I believe in.
There was no face that she dropped when she was away from the public and with people, you know, she was always Audrey. And it was a great person, a saint, an angel. All of those are just words, but I think all of them applied.
The most common question that I am asked was, what was she really like? For people who look to Audrey because they think she's compassionate, because they think she's elegant, because they think she's glamorous, that they can look with confidence because she is all of those things.
I think that the greatest lesson, if you can call it a lesson, is that she gave me the faith to believe in love. I had a great relationship. She was my best friend.
Today, Audrey's legacy lives on. In 1994, her family formed the Audrey Hepburn Hollywood for Children Fund in her memory to carry on her selfless work for children.
The Audrey Hepburn Hollywood for Children Fund basically embraces the entire entertainment community in helping children's causes around the world. You don't have to be famous to help. But the one thing that we really want is for people who have a specific cause in their community or in their state or wherever. If there are children in need, we want to know about it, and we want to see what we can do to help.
We'll help you make your charitable dream come true, as long as it's for kids.
On her last Christmas, Audrey read her family a poem that expressed her philosophy of life, a philosophy she shared with the world, and one her son, Sean, continues to share in her memory.
For attractive lips, speak words of kindness. For lovely eyes, seek out the good in people. For a slim figure, share your food with the hungry. For beautiful hair, let a child run his fingers through it once a day. For poise, walk with the knowledge you'll never walk alone. Relieve your tradition with the future. The tender, loving care of human beings will never become obsolete. People, even more than things, have to be restored, renewed, revived, reclaimed, and redeemed, and redeemed, and redeemed. Never throw out anybody. Remember, if you ever need a helping hand, you'll find one at the end of your arm. As you grow older, you will discover that you have two hands. One for helping yourself, the other for helping others. Your good old days are still ahead of you. May you have many of them.
At the mercy of a man.
You know, I really believe there's a part of him that loves me.
And ignored by a system.
He's threatening to kill me!
A woman who became a victim fought back the only way she could. See her stunning true life story.
The police are liable to Tracy Thurman because they violated her civil rights.
In a cry for help.
I'm gonna get you for that!
The Tracy Thurman story.
Tonight at 9, 8 Central on Lifetime.
Gone away on a trip, and she didn't think he was coming back. I was terribly jealous of other little girls who did have adoring daddies and all of that. And my mother did a wonderful thing. She never, ever spoke against him.
In 1939, war broke out in Europe. A year later, Hitler invaded Holland. And for 5 long years, war became a way of life for young Audrey.
Throughout our youth, she would always talk about what it's like to grow up environment where the basics that we're used to in today's world are not there, and you don't have your freedom, you're not able to go and say as you please. I think that's really what shocked her the most.
We lived by the day, then little by little, yes, there was a knock on the door and they took my uncle away, who 6 months later was shot, and another uncle too, and my brothers went underground that's when really the hard time started, because that's when so many reprisals were made and so many people were shot and so many people were rounded up and imprisoned. We did not yet know that they were going to their death.
Horrors of the Second World War and suffered from malnutrition. Her meteoric rise to stardom was clouded by divorce and miscarriage, leaving her to fear that lifelong love and the joys of motherhood would elude her. But Audrey's positive outlook helped her overcome whatever obstacles life handed her. She never took her stardom for granted and ultimately found a way to use her fame as a means to give back to others, devoting herself during the last years of her life to children around the world.
Being without food or being fearful for one's own life or bombings or fighting and all of that has made me terribly appreciative, of course, of food, of safety, of liberty. So in that sense, what were bad experiences have become positive in my life.
When Audrey died in 1993, the legacy she left behind would make her one of the most beloved celebrities of all time. In her last rare appearances, Audrey, her son Sean Ferrer, and her last companion in life, Robert Walters, take us inside the world of this very private woman. Tonight, Audrey Hepburn, an intimate portrait. Audrey Hepburn Rustin was born May 4, 1929 in Brussels, Belgium, the daughter of a Dutch baroness, Ella von Heemstra, and her second husband, Joseph Hepburn Rustin, an Irish banker. Born to Dutch nobility, Audrey and her two half-brothers, Jan and Alexander, enjoyed a privileged life during their early years. But the 1930s were a time of great unrest in Europe, when Hitler was coming into power, and the comfortable life Audrey knew would soon change dramatically. When she was 6 years old, Audrey's father left home. The feelings of abandonment she suffered at losing the father she adored would be something she would struggle with her entire life.
There was a great deal of pain involved, because before the war, after he'd left us, my mother explained very sweetly that those images have never left me.
Prior to the war, Audrey had discovered a love for dance, studying ballet with a passion. Though later she would downplay her involvement, during the war she did what she could to put her dancing skills to good use, giving ballet recitals to raise funds for the Dutch resistance. But as the war dragged on, deprivation and malnourishment took their toll, and Audrey was too ill to dance. Then, on her 16th birthday, Holland was officially liberated. It was a day filled with memories that would impact Audrey's life many years later.
The day we were liberated was so exciting, and that's when life started again. The first thing I remember after our liberation in Holland was the Red Cross and UNICEF coming in and filling all the empty buildings that they could find with food and clothing and medication. So that was the first time I became aware of the word. It was then UNRWA and became UNICEF. Everything was new, everything was exciting, and that has stayed with me till today.
After the war, Audrey's mother single-handedly supported Audrey and herself in England, but her daughter's dream to be a great dancer would never. Tonight, on Intimate Portrait.
David, would you like to kiss me?
Would I?
Yes. A nice, steady kiss. Not on roller skates this time.
Roller skates?
You don't remember.
I remember I had a pair of roller skates.
I was 9 years old, and you had your arms around me because you were teaching me to skate backwards. And suddenly you kissed me. I've never forgotten.
Her chic style, everlasting grace, and noble spirit made her one of the most intriguing people in history. From the moment she appeared on the screen, Audrey Hepburn had the ability to make audiences fall in love with her. Her unique combination of naivete and sophistication skyrocketed her to stardom almost overnight. She was paired on screen with some of the greatest leading men Hollywood had to offer, from Gregory Peck and Cary Grant to Fred Astaire and Sean Connery. Yet behind her regal beauty, Audrey's life was filled with complicated twists and turns. As a child, she witnessed the